So you were talking about this fasting mimetic diet in humans, this clinical study in humans that you had, or pilot trial that you had done in humans, where you're, is there, so with the mouse studies and the fasting and the autophagy and the regenerating of the stem cells, and you know, that stuff's all very exciting and has relevance for, you know, for cancer and for aging in general, but how can you translate like a 48-hour fast to humans? And is that sort of why you've come up with this fasting mimetic diet? Because the amount of time would have to be like a week or 5 days or something that seems a lot more difficult for humans to do.
Yeah, so it's not just about difficulty. It's also about safety. And so when we first started with the fasting in cancer patients, basically the patients didn't want to do it and the doctors didn't want to do it. Yeah, so it's really a struggle, and it took us forever here at the Norris Cancer Center, our own university, to get 18 patients to go through it. It took us like 5 or 6 years. So it was very difficult. And then we started asking people, what if we gave you a fasting mimicking diet? And we started asking doctors, what if we give patients a box and it has all the foods that they need? So it's more of a medicine, right? You just hand over to the patient a medicine. And then everything turned around. So people were much more likely to do it. They felt like
some more compliance.
Psychologically, we give them something. They also, of course, they're eating almost normally. I mean, normally in the sense at the right times. They're not eating normally. Obviously, the diet is very different than the normal diet. And the doctors felt good about it. So I think it was really important to get the fasting mimicking diet going. And, you know, so now we have a number of trials, both in cancer patients, in diabetes patients. Soon enough, we'll start with, we finish one in multiple sclerosis. So now we're ready to start talking to the FDA about moving to the next level. I think people are underestimating the power of this. And that's good and bad, I guess. But I think that it's got real potential. As we're seeing now that we're talking to doctors, and now we're seeing a lot of doctors, cardiologists, endocrinologists, gynecologists, prescribing it, right? Or recommending it. They're not prescribing, it's not a drug, but they're recommending it to patients. And it's been great. You know, now we have a couple hundred doctors that we're talking to, but to see this group of people change from this drug centered mentality to maybe there are things that we didn't realize could be very powerful and much more able to, again, let the body fix itself. And so I would not be surprised if in 10 years worldwide these type of interventions are going to be standard in the doctor's office.
Wow, that's really cool.